ओके कूल। या सो हेलो एवरीवन, सबसे पहले मेरे को एक क्वेश्चन है कि हाउ मेनी ऑफ यू आर कंफर्टेबल विद हिंदी एंड इंग्लिश बोथ? एंड आई सी सम पीपल हु आर नॉट कंफर्टेबल विद बोथ, सो ऑल राइट प्लीज कीप इट इन इंग्लिश। ओके श्योर, सो लेट्स स्टार्ट। लेट मी जस्ट स्विच ऑन द वे। ओके सो टुडे वी विल स्टार्ट विद दिस न्यू थिंग व्हिच मोस्ट ऑफ यू माइट नॉट हैव सीन इफ यू आर इन 11th और 12th ग्रेड। वी विल एक्चुअली सी हाउ दीज टेंसेस आर यूज्ड इन स्पेशल रिलेटिविटी। सो this session is going to be containing a lot of things, but these are actually I have designed them so that you can easily understand them, and even if you don't understand them, then I have prepared some additional material. Actually, it's just something from the books. So there are two books that I will be using. These are the David J. Griffith's Introduction to Electrodynamics and the Afkin Mathematical Methods for Physicists. So this book actually contains the idea of tensors in a much compact way, so you don't have to worry about all the mathematical details. You just understand the basic ideas of tensors. And in this, I will actually specify you the pages that you have to study after the class for additional reading, so that you get more familiar with what I have taught here. And in Griffith's, the idea of relativity is there, so there's no need to do anything else. You can solve the problems, which is always a good practice. So I would highly encourage you to solve problems from David J. Griffiths, and it has a very nice problem set. Also, if you have any doubt anywhere in between the session, so please unmute yourself and ask the doubt, because at the end, I know you might not be able to track your doubt. So it's better if you ask the doubt when it comes to your mind. That would actually benefit all of us, so that we do not deviate from the topic. All right. So we will start with some motivation as to why we should study about tensors and why they are useful. This is actually mostly going to be in the realm of relativity, and more specifically special relativity. Then we will see what tensors are and a basic introduction to them. I'm not going to go into the full details of tensors, but this will be more like a review of what you will actually study if you take a full course on tensors. Then we talk about the metric tensor. Metric tensor is actually something that I have already talked about in a previous video, which you might have watched. So if you haven't actually, you can actually find the link. Badal or Samar, they will provide the link to that video. Then we will actually see how they are used in special relativity, and after that we will actually derive the famous E equals MC square, which you might have seen some videos on YouTube, but most of the proofs I have seen, they are not very rigorous. So that's why I wanted to do justice for this derivation, and that's why I will be deriving this using tensorial relativity, which is the more rigorous proof. So yeah, that's the basic idea of the course. So right now, if any of you have any question relating to the topics that we will be discussing, you can actually ask them right now. Yeah, anyone, please speak up, unmute yourself. Okay, I guess nobody has a question. That's actually the scenario with online class most of the time. So yeah, we start. First of all, we are going to see why are tensors, anyway useful for us. So if you know a little bit about Lorentz transformation, which I would highly recommend you to watch that video on Lorentz transformation, There are multiple videos on YouTube also, which actually explain the idea of Lorentz transformation. But in the video that I have uploaded, I have actually explained through animations some of the ideas of how Lorentz transformation actually work. So the basic idea is very simple. Let's say you have this person who is in the reference frame S. We call it reference frame S. And there is another person in the reference frame S prime. So what we just want to do is we want to figure out what the position of this, what you can say, this person looks like in the frame of this S reference frame. So this coordinate system basically represents the position with respect to X and the time with respect to S. So there is something called the differences in time in special relativity. That means you have a different time in every frame. So that's why we have the idea of time dilation and length contraction, because we have different times for different reference frame. And this idea is at its core because of the constant nature of the speed of light. So there are multiple things to consider in special theory of relativity, but the thing that is going to help you the most is the constant nature of the speed of light. And this is actually why these ideas emerge out and we study them. Okay, so let's go ahead. So ye Lorentz transformation hai, and in this Lorentz transformation, what you can see is we have these linear transformation, what you can call. These are constants. They only depend on the velocity. This beta depends only on the velocity of the particle, right? So, or the reference frame that we are considering, this S prime. Okay. If any of you who are not familiar with this equation, I would suggest you to watch the video. It's a very compact explanation of how we got this. Also, you will get an idea of how these transformations work. Okay. Now, yes, boson. What are the questions that you're asking? Okay, sorry. If any of you have any question, please speak up. Don't write it in the chat box because I'm not able to read them simultaneously. Okay. So, yeah, without deviating, what we do actually in special theory of relativity to get to the idea of tensors, we actually make this CT as another component in the whole realm of space-time. So what we have is, in one-dimensional motion, we have one dimension of space and one dimension of time. So this idea actually tells us that we have a space-time, right? This space and this time part actually constitute the whole idea of space-time. So, yeah. Okay. So to represent that, what we do is essentially we take this first component and make it, an indexed tensor, or just say you can understand it like simply x0 and x1. So these are just, just simple numbers, what you can call. But we are assigning it such that we can represent them as a whole entity, not two different entities of space and time. So this is a single entity, to be more precise. So this actually represents the position or the time and the space with respect to the frame S, this frame. And this actually represents the position and space, or position and time. This is the position and this is the time part with respect to this S prime frame. So what we do is we denote this using X prime 0 and X prime 1. And what we have here is something called the Lorentz matrix. It's more generally called the boost, but we can call it the Lorentz transformation matrix to be more simpler. And it is actually represented by this symbol lambda. You might have studied about this most of the time. So lambda ij, this is the matrix element of the ith row and jth column. So this is simply very, very simple. Now, this actually helps us in many ways. For example, in 2D, you might not realize this, or in one-dimensional motion, you might not realize that how useful this is, because we can always write down the equations. But think about if we consider the full three-dimensional version that will constitute three dimension of space and one dimension of time. Then you will have a 4x4 matrix. And you will have exactly four equations, which are very, very hard to write if you were to consider them writing separately. That's why this idea of writing in terms of matrices actually helps a lot. Also, one more thing that we do is we switch these indexes from bottom to top. You know, this actually represents a contravariant tensor. I haven't actually told you a lot about these things. What are these upper indexes? But remember, these are not powers. So this is not power or exponent, as you call it. Exponent. Okay. This is just an index. Like, you know, hum aise keh sakte hain that we have x1 is equal to some number, let's say 4. Similarly, x1 is equal to 4. But x2 is not at all equal to 16. It's a different number. We are just indexing things for convenience, nothing else. There is no other way to actually define the idea of the contravariant tensors. So that's why we usually write the upper and lower indices to define this idea. I will actually explain this later when we study about tensors, but this is just the motivation of why we are studying tensors. And in the next slide, we will actually see how to deal with these indexes in the upper part. They're not exponents. That's the basic idea that you have to keep in mind. Okay. Now, in four-dimensional space-time, which has three dimensions of space and one dimension of time, with respect to the frame S, you have the position of any particle. So this is actually representing the position of any particle. This x prime is representing the position of any particle. Let's say it could be a ball with respect to the frame S prime. And this represents the position of this particle with respect to the frame S. Okay. So this actually is going to be x0. This is going to be x1. This is going to be x2. This is going to be x3. Now this x0 is... just your CT. This CT is actually, which is the time part, can be represented as x0. And this is actually x, this is y, and this is z. We have just used the upper indices to denote indexes, nothing else, no exponent. All right. Now we move forward and we think about what is going to be here on this side. Well, we can actually see that it's going to be x prime of 0. This is actually representing the temporal part with respect to the s prime coordinate. And if we move forward, x prime 1, x prime 2, x prime 3. So this is a basic idea of why we use these tensors, because they actually help us in writing these things up. Now, one good idea is to think about what is going to be here. Well, I'm not going to actually derive it. There is a nice Wikipedia article about what this four-dimensional boost is. And if you search it on Wikipedia, it's actually this beast that we can see here. But, deriving this would be way out of this class, because it's only 1.5 hours. So we will move forward and study about a little bit about tensors, and then we will move on to derive the famous E equals mc squared. All right. So, sabse pehle, I want to ask if any of you have any doubt. Koi bhi doubt ho kisi ko? So just please unmute yourself and speak up. Any doubt it could be. It's an interactive session. So otherwise it would have been a single video that I would have uploaded. So please speak up and I would love to answer your question. No one? Bhai, ye class nahi hai, ye simple ek session hai, aise koi official class mat samjho ise. You can ask your doubts, any doubt you have. Okay, cool. Right. So this idea was to just to motivate you for tensors. It has not a very big deal. It's not a very big deal to think about. This is just for motivation purpose. Now we will move forward and you know, actually ye sab advance aa raha hai isliye koi kuch nahi bol raha hai. Yes, you can introduce people's what is relevant. Survey to sab. Okay, cool. I thought just a minute. Okay, so just a minute. I see. I understand. It's not very easy to understand. So how can I make it easier? Assume people knows only 12 things. Yes. I understand that. So we can do one thing. I know that this tensor stuff is a little advanced for all of you. You know, I would have also not known in 12th grade about tensors, and I completely agree with you. But I just wanted to derive this nice idea of equals mc square. But I just want to actually give you one hint about this. Simple idea. Okay, so one thing that we can do is yes. Okay, so we can first start with this visual intuition that you all might be familiar with. And I'm going to actually think about. Okay, एक चीज़ मैं आप सबसे पूछना चाहता हूँ कि if I start with visuals, then would that be clear to all of you? Because I will just be using algebra, nothing advanced, nothing else. You can speak up.
Yeah, I think that would be clear.
Okay. So what we can do initially is, first of all, I can give you a little hint of special relativity. And then I would actually tell you one fact about tensors. Which is actually going to be useful, but you don't have to actually memorize this or anything else. It's a very, very simple thing, and I will actually give you a visual hint as to why that is true. So just forget about the idea of what we have discussed about tensors, because I know that it's not very comfortable with all of you. So we are just going to think about it visually now. All right. So first of all, let's consider these two particles. इनमें the one with s prime frame is actually moving with some velocity. तो ये कोई भी हो सकता है, ये आपका दोस्त होगा और this is me or anyone. So when your friend is moving with respect to you with velocity v, what will you observe? आपको यही दिखेगा ना कि वो particle और वो जो आपका friend है, he actually moves you know v times t. He will travel this much distance in t time, but the thing is that time is relative to both of us. So I will actually experience the distance he has traveled. So with respect to me, the time t has passed, but with respect to him, the time t prime has passed. Right. So this actually idea of different times will make the length to be different in both of the frames. So in your frame, you might have seen the time to be vt prime, or you might have traveled this much distance. But in my frame, I would see this much distance that you have traveled. So this actually causes the difference in or the idea of these equations of Lorentz transformation. All right. Okay. Now let's do an analogy with the light. How light works. Okay, सबको पता है ये बात कि स्पीड ऑफ द लाइट इज कॉन्स्टेंट इन एनी रेफरेंस फ्रेम बिकॉज आई मीन इट्स जस्ट अ पोस्टुलेट बट वी हैव एक्चुअली फाउंड अ पार्टिकल कॉल्ड टेक्यून विच हैज इमेजिनरी मास एंड स्पीड ऑफ दैट पार्टिकल इज एक्चुअली फास्टर देन लाइट but that particle actually only exists in string theory, so that is actually a hypothetical particle. But the only thing that we know to be moving at the fastest speed is light, which moves at the speed c, and with every frame, with respect to every frame, it has a speed of light to be equal to c. Now let's assume ki light jo hai wo move kar rahi hai. Now is frame ke respect mein bhi koi bhi agar main light ki beam yahan se chhodunga तो वो सी स्पीड से जाएगी और इस फ्रेम के रिस्पेक्ट में भी वो सी स्पीड से जाएगी, राइट? नाउ व्हाट हैपेंस इज कि इस पार्टिकल के और इस फ्रेम में जो स्पीड ऑफ लाइट सी होगी वो होगी डी एक्स प्राइम बाय डी टी प्राइम. इज दिस क्लियर टू ऑल?
यस.
ओके. एंड इन द फ्रेम ऑफ एस दिस विल बी इक्वल टू डी एक्स बाय डी टी. Right. So now what we can do is simply think about this equation. Now this dx is actually just a displacement of that photon with respect to the frame s prime, and this dx is actually the displacement of the photon in this frame. Now since c is a constant of universe for speed of light, what we can essentially do here is equate these two equations, right? So dx prime is equal to c dt prime, and dx is equal to c dt. All right. Now in dono equations, say I know it's a little mouthful to say ki we can actually generalize into three dimension. बट थ्री डिमेंशन में क्या होगा? थ्री डिमेंशन में यही होगा ना कि c इज इक्वल टू डी आर प्राइम बाई डी टी का मैग्नीट्यूड. दिस इज जस्ट सिंपल वेक्टर, नथिंग एल्स. देयर इज नो टेंसर राइट नाउ. एंड इन द फ्रेम ऑफ दिस s वी विल हैव डी आर बाई डी टी, राइट? नाउ व्हाट वी कैन डू इज वी कैन एक्चुअली डू द सेम थिंग. मॉड्यूलस ऑफ डी आर. Now, आप में से कुछ लोग ऐसा बोलोगे कि वी कैन नॉट डू दिस मल्टीप्लीकेशन बाई डी टी, बट माई रीजनिंग इज दैट दिस आइडिया इज एक्चुअली सेइंग कि अगर हमारे पास एक फोटोन यहाँ पे है और वो जस्ट एक इन्फिनिटेसिमल टाइम के बाद यहाँ पे गया, तो उसने डी आर डिस्टेंस ट्रेवल किया विद रिस्पेक्ट टू द फ्रेम एस, राइट? और फ्रेम एस के रिस्पेक्ट में उसने टाइम डी टी लगाया यहाँ पॉइंट ए से पॉइंट बी जाने में. सो दैट वुड मीन दैट द वेलोसिटी ऑफ दिस फोटोन विद रिस्पेक्ट टू द फ्रेम एस इज सी इज इक्वल टू डी आर बाई डी टी. सो दिस इज इन फ्रेम एस एंड दिस इज इन फ्रेम एस प्राइम. सो वन थिंग दैट वी कैन सी फ्रॉम हियर इज दिस क्वांटिटी कैन बी अरेंज्ड सच दैट सॉरी इट वॉज डी टी sorry for my fault. So c dt prime minus mod dr prime, and agar main chahu to dono taraf square bhi kar sakta hu, it's not a problem, just to make it magnitude square. Also yahan pe bhi main yahi same cheez kar sakta hu, c dt square is equal to mod dr square. All right. Okay. Just a minute. Like मैं आप एज ऐड कर दूँ. Okay. So हमने S frame में अभी भी क्या derive किया कि C dt square minus mod dr square is equal to zero. एंड सेम चीज एस प्राइम फ्रेम में भी हमने डिराइव किया अभी अभी डिफरेंट कलर्स लिखा सी डी टी प्राइम स्क्वायर माइनस मॉड डी आर प्राइम स्क्वायर इज इक्वल टू जीरो. ओके. Now, this can be actually arranged so that this dr square can be written as, you know, हमें पता है कि अगर हम कार्टेशियन कोऑर्डिनेट में देखें तो dr को हम dx, dy और dz के कंपोनेंट्स में ब्रेक कर सकते हैं. सो यूजिंग पाइथागोरियन थ्योरम हम इसको स्प्लिट कर सकते हैं इन थ्री डायरेक्शंस. तो दिस cdt square इज एक्चुअली गोइंग टू बी माइनस dx square plus dy square plus dz square, right? So ये जो चीज है light के केस में ये चीज जीरो आ रही है. This is actually what we call interval. This is actually the relativistic interval in special theory of relativity. इसको मैंने बहुत सिंपल तरीके से आपको डिराइव करके दिखाया है. देर आर मेनी मोर थिंग्स टू कंसिडर इफ यू आर डिराइविंग द जनरलाइज इंटरवल, बट दिस इज एक्चुअली समथिंग यू नो लूज इंटुएशन अबाउट हाउ दिस कैन बी डिराइव. इन दिस केस आई हैव यूज ओनली द एग्जाम्पल ऑफ लाइट, बट ये चीज हम किसी भी दो इवेंट्स के लिए कर सकते हैं. दो इवेंट का मतलब एक पॉइंट ए है जो कि हम रिप्रेजेंट कर रहे हैं उसे टाइम t1 और स्पेस के कोऑर्डिनेट्स r से, और एक पॉइंट बी है जिसको हम रिप्रेजेंट कर रहे हैं t2 कॉमा r से. नाउ आपको यहाँ पे एक चीज दिख रही होगी कि ये जो i है यहाँ पे भी वही सेम चीज आया है, माइनस dx स्क्वायर माइनस dy स्क्वायर और प्राइम के साथ माइनस dz प्राइम स्क्वायर. So, दोनों फ्रेम्स में चाहे एस फ्रेम हो या चाहे एस प्राइम फ्रेम हो, आई इज इक्वल टू जीरो आएगा फॉर लाइट. ये लाइट के केस के लिए. नाउ व्हाट डू आई मीन कि मैं ऐसा क्यों बोल रहा हूँ कि ये लाइट के लिए, बिकॉज हमने अभी भी कंसीडर किया था कि एक फोटोन के लिए, या यहाँ पे हमने फोटोन की एनालॉजी लेके ये केस निकाला है. यू नो वन डायमेंशन में खाली dx आएगा, थ्री डायमेंशन में dx, dy और dz भी आ जाएंगे, बट ये जो हमने आई निकाला यहाँ पे, आई को जो हमने डिराइव किया, दिस इज एक्चुअली अ कंजर्व क्वांटिटी ऑफ लॉरेंट ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन. सो लेट मी जस्ट राइट इट आउट. और ऐसा किसी भी फोर वेक्टर के लिए होगा जो कि यू नो लॉरेंट ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन जो मैट्रिक्स था, और यहाँ पे हम कोई भी एक फोर वेक्टर यूज करते तो जो x, जैसे यहाँ पे x0 होता है, यहाँ पे x1 होता है एंड x3 तक आता, एंड यहाँ पे x prime 0 एंड अप टू आगे. तो ये जो i है, ये i एक्चुअली कांस्टेंट रहता है इन एनी फ्रेम. आप किसी भी फ्रेम में ऑब्जर्व करो, ये i इनवेरिएंट रहता है. तो इसको हम लॉरेंट्स इनवेरिएंट भी बोल देते हैं टू बी मोर प्रिसाइज. एंड इसको हम एक्चुअली ऐसे लिख सकते हैं, dx0 का स्क्वायर माइनस ऑल दी अदर थिंग्स. तो ये वाला हमारा टाइम वाला कंपोनेंट था जिसको हम सी डी टी बोलते, जिसको हम सी टी बोलते थे, राइट, सी टाइम्स टी. एंड यही सेम चीज में यहाँ से बस यू नो सी टी को मैं यहाँ से यूज करके और यहाँ पे लिख दे रहा हूँ, नथिंग एल्स. यहाँ पे हमारे पास डी एक्स वन का स्क्वायर प्लस डी एक्स टू का स्क्वायर प्लस डी एक्स थ्री का स्क्वायर हो जाएगा. ओके, या एनी डाउट किसी को? ओके कूल. अगर नहीं समझ आ रहा है तो देन यू कैन जस्ट आस्क योर क्वेश्चन.
एंड इज द बिग थिंग दैट यू शो शोड इन द बिग थिंग, राइट?
क्या चीज? हेलो,
L is the big thing that you showed in the beginning, right?
Yes, yes, yes. So just a minute. You're talking about this, right? Hello?
Yes, yes.
Okay, okay. So yeah, this is actually the four vectors that we essentially talked about. यहाँ पे सिंपली वी हैव दिस सी टी एज द फर्स्ट कंपोनेंट. दिस इज जस्ट अ वेक्टर, यू कैन कंसिडर इट एज अ फोर डायमेंशनल वेक्टर. आपने वेक्टर्स जैसे देखे हैं, लाइक आप वेक्टर को लिखते हो ऐसे लिखते होगे 1, 2, 3, यू नो इन थ्री डायमेंशन दिस इज इट. बट इन फोर डायमेंशन वी एक्चुअली यूज दिस नोटेशन. इट्स जस्ट अ नोटेशन, इसको हम ऐसे इक्विवेलेंट भी लिख सकते हैं 1, 2, 3, नो बिग डील. एंड दिस इज ऑल्सो अ वेक्टर, बट since it has four components hum isko four vector bol lete hain, nothing else. That's very simple idea. Now I had a lot of things in mind to derive, but I guess it's a little hard for you to understand right now, so I'm going to make it super easy to understand. So if this part is clear to all, then I think that's great, and then we can move forward. So is this clear to all?
Yes.
Okay, yeah. Now this is actually very useful. This you know, we can actually use this thing to derive multiple ideas in relativity, and that is what I'm going to be using right now. You know, I had in mind to talk about the metric tensor and how metric tensor actually gives rise to this invariant, but this simple analogy also helps you, so I guess that's it. But if any of you want to learn more about it, then please stay till the end, and I will actually be happy to answer all of your questions. So yeah, this was a simple analogy so that all of you can understand. Right now, I think we can actually start with the thing that we wanted to derive in special relativity. So since we haven't actually touched this generalized Lorentz transformation, so I'm not going to use it now. I'm going to use the simple one-dimensional Lorentz transformation, which all of you are comfortable with, right?
Right.
Okay. So, yeah. So, the Lorentz transformation for one-dimensional case is like this. Correct me if something goes wrong. Okay. Right. So this is what we have for the one-dimensional Lorentz transformation. Now consider ki ye aap ho aur yahan pe koi frame S hai, and with respect to this frame S, you are moving with velocity u. So this is in any direction this could be, but we are just interested in the time. There will be one time that this S frame is going to be measuring, which is going to be the time t. But there will be another time that u will be measuring, which will be the time t prime. So iske liye ek analogy Griffiths mein de rakhi hai, and that the analogy is goes like this. You are in a plane, and the plane moving with some velocity, and the pilot announces that with respect to the ground or the frame S, we are moving with some velocity u. You know, it could be 100 meter per second or anything. So with respect to ground, this velocity u is measured, but what is the velocity of the plane with respect to you, or who is sitting in the plane? You are sitting in the plane, so what is the velocity of the plane with respect to you, or what is your velocity with respect to you? Can anyone answer that?
I think zero.
Yeah, that's cool. Because you see, with respect to yourself, you are not moving at all. You're just stationary. That's great. So this is the only thing that we are going to use now. And most of you might be familiar with derivatives, and that's why I'm going to use them now. So this equation can be transformed easily. You know, just apply the d operator both sides. So this can be written as c dt prime is equal to c dt minus beta dx. Okay, so now I would like to ask a question to all of you. What do you think this dx is going to be if I'm observing in my frame, or this person S prime observes in his frame? What is this dx going to be? Any guesses? I would be happy to know your thought process. you know, you see the you are not moving at all with respect to yourself. So will your position change with respect to yourself?
No, it wouldn't. Yeah.
So what would this dx be?
Zero.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was saying. Right. Then what we can conclude here, this dt prime. Now this dt prime is the time that you are measuring, right? Which is going to be, actually we cancel out the c's because this goes to zero, and we have gamma d. Now we know what this gamma is. It is 1 over under root 1 minus beta square, right? So this is actually very, very important, dt prime. This is what we call as the proper time, you know, the time that you are observing with respect to yourself. So you are in a flight, you are not concerned about what the ground time is. You're concerned about the time with respect to yourself, because let's say you are on the flight and you want to reach some place. And let's say you are thinking about, you know, sleeping. So you would be thinking that I'm sleeping right now. So how much more time do I have to sleep so that I can reach the destination and be awake at the time when I reach there? You wouldn't consider the time that with the ground, you would consider the time that you are observing, right? So that's why this proper time, dt prime, is the time that you are observing with respect to yourself. And this is actually going to be very, very useful once we go here, talk about the proper velocity. So only thing that you have to keep in mind is this proper time is represented as tau. You know, it's just a variable, so dummy variable, it doesn't matter. You can call it any way, whatever you want, but you know, I'm just calling it tau. So this equation is actually useful because this represents, this dt represents that, actually, let me just change the color. So yeah, this dt represents the time that is passed with respect to the ground. And this d tau represents the time, which is the proper time that you are observing, that is passed with respect to yourself. All right. So is that clear to all of you?
Yeah, clear.
Okay, cool. Now we talk about the proper velocity. So humne ye dekha ki particle jo hai wo u velocity se move kar raha hai with respect to this frame S. So can anyone tell me, you know, it could be a guess, but whatever you are thinking, just tell me, what would this velocity u be, you know, in terms of derivatives? Any guesses?
Can you repeat the question?
Let's say that this is the frame S, or we can call it the ground. And with respect to S, this person or me, I am at a position of r. Then what this velocity u is going to be?
Dr vector upon dt?
Yeah, exactly. So this is going to be dr by dt, where you have to keep in mind that this dt is with respect to the frame S, right? And now we can actually substitute this dt for this in this equation, right? So what we can get is dr over d tau over gamma, which can actually come out here. Now this is actually something pretty, pretty nice to think about. This is actually called the proper velocity. Why do we consider this proper velocity? There is a reason. This proper velocity actually transforms according to the Lorentz transformations. Now, why is that? Because yahan pe aap dekh sakte, yahan pe jo transform hone wali cheez thi, wo kya kya thi? Ek to, one question that I first of all would like to ask. Sorry, I didn't ask this earlier. This proper time, will it change from different reference frame to different reference frame? Any guesses?
Maybe, I think yes.
So you see, first of all, you have to think about what is proper time. It is the time that you are observing with respect to yourself, right? So it doesn't matter if another frame observes. You know, any frame could observe me. The proper time would remain the same because I am observing that time. The other frame is not observing. For other frame, we have this time dt. So should it change or should it not?
It won't. It should.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's exactly. That's why we are saying that we know that this R actually transforms according to the Lorentz transformation. R basically hamara xyz hai, so xyz actually transforms using the Lorentz transformation, right?
Yeah, right.
Okay, so that means ki agar hum ek aisi cheez define kare like this proper velocity, then this will also transform according to the Lorentz transformation. Jo humne Lorentz transformation ka matrix dekha tha, usme agar main is proper velocity ko main represent kar sakta hu using eta vector, you know, it's just a vector, to main isko eta vector ki tarah represent kar raha hu. So agar main is eta vector ko Lorentz transformation ke through transform karunga, then mere ko proper velocity pata chal jayegi with respect to another frame, koi dusra frame ho sakta hai. And that's why we define this idea of proper velocity. Simply, बस ये reasoning है. I'm not going to get into the full details क्योंकि वो थोड़ा ज़्यादा हो जाएगा आप सबके लिए. So let's keep it here. And एक expression जो हमारे लिए useful होगा is going to be this. U is equal to gamma times eta. Now ये three dimension में हम define कर रहे हैं. So इसके लिए first of all we have to understand कि ये gamma क्या होगा three dimension में. Any guesses? I would be happy to know. Hello.
Hello.
Yeah.
Isn't this one minus beta square? Just.
Yes, exactly. But in three dimension, what is beta in three dimensions? We know that beta is velocity over c, a ratio of v with respect to c, but. What is this beta right now?
From what I understand, beta is just u square over c square, right? So do we break u into three components?
Yes, exactly. The thing is that beta is a vector. You know, v is a vector, so beta must be a vector. This here is actually the magnitude. Sorry, it should be u. Should be u. Sorry for that. Yeah. So this beta actually represents the magnitude of this vector. This vector's magnitude, which is just going to be u by c, right? So you can actually simply understand it from the one dimensional case. In the one dimensional case, we had this beta, which was v by c. You know, this was the velocity along x direction. So that's why this three dimensional gamma is just nothing, exactly the same thing, but here for beta we substitute the magnitude of velocity, simply that. Okay, so till now everything is clear to all.
I had one doubt. Yeah. With which frame are we considering when we talk about proper velocity? Is it s1 okay. or s prime?
Yeah, that's a good question. The proper velocity is something which is not with respect to any frame. First of all, it's a hybrid velocity, what you can call. You see, this is with respect to s, right? And this is with respect to s prime. So ideally this would be something mixed up. It's not with respect to s or with respect to s prime. It's you know, it's kind of like there's a great analogy in Griffith, what they say. I'm just going to read the statement. It's a good just a minute. It's a very, very nice explanation. Yeah, so here is the statement. Let me share it with you. Yeah, so this is the statement that Griffith has about this proper velocity. So you see, he says, now imagine if you are on a flight in Los Angeles and pilot announces that the plane's velocity is this. What precisely does he mean by velocity? Well, of course, he means the displacement divided by time. This velocity is the velocity of the plane with respect to the ground. Right. And now we talk about the proper velocity. So let's see what they say. That's the important number to consider if you are concerned about being on time for an appointment in Los Angeles. But if you are wondering whether you'll be hungry on arrival, you might be more interested in the distance covered per unit proper time. So ye kuch aisa bol raha hai ki, let's say aapko apne destination pe pahunchna hai. And you are more concerned कि हम कितनी तेजी से जा रहे हैं with respect to myself. You know, हम distance consider कर रहे हैं with respect to the ground, but time consider कर रहे हैं with respect to me. तो इससे ये होगा कि मुझे अपने relative ये पता चल जाएगा कि एक तरीके का ऐसा आइडिया जो कि मेरे को ये बताएगा कि हाउ मच टाइम और हाउ मच फास्ट आई एम द प्लेन इज मूविंग विद रिस्पेक्ट टू मी. इट्स नॉट एग्जैक्टली डी आर प्राइम बाई डी टाओ बट इट्स लाइक अ हाइब्रिड थिंग. यू नो दिस इज a little you know mixed up thing but it is actually very useful when we consider the Lorentz transformation of four vectors. So if you have actually you know if you want to learn more, this section in Griffiths is very very amazing. So I would actually recommend you to read it. Also any more question on this, I would actually have a good time explaining this. So yeah, any more question? Hello?
No, I think that's all from my side.
Okay, cool. So now we can move forward and talk about the, four velocity. First of all, this is actually a three-dimensional vector. It's not at all a four vector. Four vector as we talk about in space-time. So to talk about the four velocity, let's move forward. Okay. Now, अभी तक हमने देखा कि this u is equal to gamma times eta. Is that it? यही equation थी ना? Yes, u is equal to gamma eta. Okay. Now, अब हम क्या करने वाले हैं? अब हम define करने वाले हैं इसका four dimensional variant. Any question? ओके ऑलराइट. तो हमने अभी भी देखा था कि फोर वेक्टर्स बेसिकली क्या होते हैं. फोर वेक्टर एक तरीके से टपल होंगे. यू नो इसको मैं एक्स म्यू से रिप्रेजेंट कर सकता हूँ. ये सिर्फ इंडेक्स है. यू नो जैसे आप लिखते हो ना एक्स सब आई वाई सब आई, तो ये सिर्फ एक इंडेक्स को रिप्रेजेंट कर रहा है. इट्स नॉट अ वेरी बिग डील टू कंसिडर. इट्स जस्ट अ सिंपल इंडेक्स. Okay.
Why aren't we writing this in subscript only?
Okay, so there is a big reason for that. I haven't actually got into the details about the contravariant and covariant tensors. This is actually a contravariant tensor. I can actually write it in terms of subscript also, but that would actually change the form. First of all, for your convenience, let me just write it in the subscript. Are you all familiar with this?
Can you
repeat
what
happened? Okay. So, just a minute. For this particle, or for this person, that is, you are here. This is you on the plane. And from with respect to the observer on the ground, you are at some distance r at this particular point of time. Now, this can be represented as a triple of x, y, z, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Also, one more thing I want to ask is what is the time that this s is observing right now?
Dt, simply.
It's t, yeah, right.
Yeah, it's simple.
So this t is the time. But now I want to construct a vector which actually contains all the information about time and the space. So I'm just going to make a vector which has its zeroth component as ct. Now ye ct kyu likha? Ct isliye likha tha ki dimensions ko match karwana hai. C is just a constant in special theory of relativity. To hum jab isko time ke sath multiply karenge, so it will be a distance, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So and iske baki jo components ho jayenge wo x, y, z, usual thing. ये चीज बहुत यूजफुल होती है. अब मान लो मैं ऐसा कुछ करूं कि इसको मैं एक तरीके से ऐसा समझ लो हाइब्रिड पोजीशन और स्पेस टाइम वाली पोजीशन कंसीडर करूं. इसको वैसे एक इवेंट बोला जाता है बट लेट्स से कि ये एक पोजीशन है इन द स्पेस टाइम. सब इसके मतलब इज दैट कूल टू ऑल?
या कूल.
यस.
ओके राइट. तो इसको मैं ऐसे बोल सकता हूँ कि स्पेस टाइम में एक पोजीशन है. इसको आप वेक्टर कंसीडर कर सकते हो. ऑल्दो इट्स नॉट अ वेक्टर, इट्स अ टेंसर, बट लेट्स से फॉर द सेक ऑफ इट सो दैट यू अंडरस्टैंड. नाउ अब मैंने क्या किया, अब मैंने बोला कि भाई डीपी बाई डी टी क्या होगा, डीपी बाई डी टी विल सिंपली बी डेरिवेटिव ऑफ ऑल दीज राइट. I'm not.
Yeah, right.
Let me just write it A because P can be confused with momentum. Okay, it's just a variable, so it's not a big deal. Now we will have the first component to be C, second to be dx by dt, and so on. They will be dy by dt and dz by dt. I'm not going to write that. Now this can easily be written as C, comma. Now what was this dx by dt? Can anyone tell?
Velocity.
Yeah, velocity. Okay, in terms of vector u, what is this dx by dt?
X component of velocity.
Exactly, exactly. So it is u sub x and u sub y and u sub z. Right? Now, isko I can actually write it in a more compact form. dA by dt is equal to, so मैं ऐसे लिख रहा हूँ कि जो फर्स्ट कंपोनेंट है इसको मैं यहाँ पे लिख देता हूँ एंड कॉमा करके जो बाकी सारे कंपोनेंट है ux uy uz इट कैन बी रिटन एज दिस. ओके
या
ऑलराइट. सो नाउ अब आप एक चीज देख सकते हो कि दिस u कैन बी रिप्लेस्ड विद दिस गामा टाइम्स ईटा.
या
आई एम गोइंग टू डू दैट. सो dA by dt is c comma gamma times eta. Okay, so ye ek tarike se what you can call it's more like a velocity with respect to the frame s still, but ye hybrid hai ek tarike ka. Aise samajh lo ki yahan pe hum time ka bhi component dekh rahe hain aur yahan pe hum space ka component bhi dekh rahe hain. But mere ko ab जैसे यहाँ पे मेरे पास ईटा था तो मेरे को अगर ईटा का फोर डायमेंशनल वर्जन चाहिए हो, सो इफ आई वांट टू फाइंड द फोर डायमेंशनल वर्जन ऑफ ईटा देन व्हाट विल आई डू. आई नो दैट ईटा, तो एक तरीके से यू कैन अंडरस्टैंड दिस एज द फोर डायमेंशनल वर्जन ऑफ यू. सो यू सब फोर, इज दैट कूल?
या या.
सो इफ आई वांट टू फाइंड द फोर डायमेंशनल वर्जन ऑफ ईटा वी कैन जस्ट सिंपली यूज दिस इक्वेशन. वी कैन डिवाइड द फोर डायमेंशनल वर्जन ऑफ यू by gamma, right?
Yeah, right.
Okay, so this will actually be this divided by gamma and we get c by gamma comma just a minute, I guess there is a mistake. Detail. Yeah, just a minute. I think there is some mistake that I have made. Ct prime is equal to this. Okay. I'm sorry for that. This is a little, I didn't know that. Yeah, sorry. Just a minute. This proper time should be having gamma in the denominator. And let me explain why. Just a minute. Let me erase this. Okay, cool. Now, I actually wrote the equations, flipped. So that's why we got a different result. Just a minute. Yeah. Okay. So first of all, let's start with the same Lorentz transformation matrix. Now, remember, we want to observe things with respect to our frame. That is the T prime. Right. So what we will have is... we will have the time part with respect to our frame and the position part with respect to our frame. And here we will have gamma and it should be a plus. Yeah, it should be a plus. gamma beta. You can actually flip the equations that we had initially. So let me just show you the equations that we had initially. Yeah. In these equations, you can simply change the positions, or you can just find CT and X from these equations in terms of CT prime and X prime, and you will exactly get this result. Yeah. So this actually tells us that we have CT here and X here. Okay. So from this equation, we can write CT as gamma times CT prime minus gamma beta, beta X prime. I'm sorry, I made a mistake I didn't know about. Okay, so yahan pe, the previous reasoning was a little incorrect. So let me explain this once again. And agar koi doubt hai, so just please ask the question. Okay, so again, we are going to take the derivative and we are going to have C dt prime minus beta dx prime. All right. Now this is actually the correct reasoning. This position is with respect to u, right? Dx prime. So if we are considering the position of mine with respect to mine, then there should be no change with respect to time, right?
Yes. Right.
So this should be zero. Dx should not be zero. I was wrong and I accept that mistake. So this should be zero now. And from here we can get dt is equal to gamma times dt prime. So this actually tells us that d tau must be dt by gamma. The earlier equation was actually incorrect that I wrote. So it's to be forgotten. But yeah, we should have to learn from our mistakes. So that's what we are doing right now. And so in this equation, there will be a slight change that eta will have the gamma to be inversed, right?
Yeah, in the denominator.
Yes, exactly. So this we can make here and divide by gamma. Okay. So that is cool. And this should be in the denominator.
In the second equation, it should be multiplied, right? Because it was multiplied earlier. So it should be gamma times.
Okay. Yeah. Dt is equal to, okay, 1 over gamma, right? Cool. And gamma also here. Okay, so in this case, we will have u is equal to, this should be divided. So we will have gamma here. And also in this equation, just a minute, the gamma must be coming in the denominator, right? Because this u will be equal to eta by gamma.
Yeah, right.
Okay. All right. So then we will just see what is eta in the four dimension. Eta in the four dimension is going to be gamma times u, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So that means if we multiply this whole thing by gamma, we will get gamma c comma eta. Okay. So this is actually correct. Previously, it was a little out of the blue. Okay, now this eta is actually, we know what is eta, it is gamma times u. We can replace that also. I don't know why I wrote this, but yeah. So this is actually what we call the four dimensional proper velocity. It is gamma times c comma gamma times u. And if we take out the gamma, which you can do because it's a vector, so it's not a big problem. Now this is actually an equivalent sign, first of all, because I'm just writing a four-dimensional vector, which is what we are referring to as here, a tensor. So if you have any doubt, please ask right now.
No.
Okay, cool. So now we are going to see the proper velocity is done and now four momentum. Okay, so momentum, as we all know, is something, you know, velocity times the mass. So that is actually also the case in special theory of relativity with just a slight correction. So what do I mean by that? We just derived that E eta in the four dimensions, eta in the four dimension is equivalent to what was it? C times, yeah,
gamma u.
Okay, C times gamma comma gamma u. Now actually here we are going to define the proper momentum, not exactly the momentum that you might be familiar with, which is the simple this u times the mass, but we are going to define the proper momentum. So any guesses for what the proper momentum should be? We know that this is actually an expression for proper velocity in the four dimensions or space time, but what would be the four momentum? Any guesses?
Is it m into gamma u?
Yes, exactly. But if we want to consider the four dimension of that, we would have to multiply the mass with this, right? Proper velocity. Any doubts?
Yeah.
Okay. So this will be mass times. So first of all, ek to pehle hum three dimension case ko dekhte hain. You know, four dimension ekdam se aa jane se, it's a little out of the blue. तो पहले थ्री डिमेंशंस को देखते हैं. प्रॉपर वेलोसिटी वाज ईटा इज इक्वल टू गामा टाइम्स यू, राइट? दैट मींस दैट प्रॉपर मोमेंटम पी प्रॉपर मस्ट बी इक्वल टू मास एट रेस्ट टाइम्स ईटा. एग्जैक्टली ये होना चाहिए.
यस
यस.
ओके, अब अगर मैं इसको फोर डिमेंशन में लिखना चाहूं, देन व्हाट विल आई राइट? It will simply be, you know, this equation को हमें four dimension में extend करना है. तो हम क्या करेंगे? Eta का four dimensional version use करने वाले हैं.
Yeah, your time.
Yes.
Okay, so this can then be written as C times m naught times gamma, comma gamma p. Okay. So, इस तरीके से ये जो अब हमारे पास चीज आई है इसको एनर्जी मोमेंटम टेंसर बोलते हैं एंड वी कैन एक्चुअली रिप्रेजेंट इट यूजिंग दिस.
एक्सक्यूज, सॉरी सर.
या
एम नॉट यू पी कैसे? एम नॉट यू तो हमने एम नॉट सॉरी पी तो हमने एम नॉट का ईटा लिखा था ना ऊपर.
हां सॉरी सॉरी, दिस इज पी प्रॉपर.
ओके,
एंड दिस इज द पी व्हिच इज यू नो एम नॉट टाइम्स यू.
ओके,
सो I will actually specify whether it is the proper momentum or it is the usual momentum. So it's the usual momentum right now. If we want to write the proper momentum, we can write it like this. M naught gamma C comma P proper. Okay. So इसको हम बोलते हैं energy momentum tensor. ये general theory of relativity में बहुत ज़्यादा useful होता है. Because of the fact that it describes the energy and momentum. अब energy कहाँ पे? Energy के बारे में आप सोचोगे. So that is also there. Just a minute, I will explain how it comes. Energy momentum tensor. Okay. तो ये हमारे पास momentum का part है. अब आप सबसे पहले एक चीज notice करो, and that is कि what happens if velocity of the particle, which is u, approaches zero. What do you think would happen to this energy momentum tensor? Any guesses?
It simply becomes m naught gamma c.
But what would gamma become as u approaches zero?
Gamma. So just one?
Yes, exactly. So this will be one. And then this p mu will become m naught times c comma. This p sub p will actually, you know, gamma becomes one. So this will be only the usual momentum. Correct? This actually suggests us that with respect to a frame in which the particle is not moving, and that frame is the particle's frame itself, the energy moment or the momentum tensor, the four momentum, is actually this. Now I'm going to show you a little nice thing, and that is, what if we were to do this? What you have on the upside is you know, the rest mass energy, that Einstein actually derived in his paper.
What is the difference between the rest mass and the simple
okay.
mass?
Okay. This actually can go two ways. You can define the rest velocity and rest momentum and the moving momentum, which is the proper momentum. But the rest mass is actually let's see think about it like this. When you are sitting at your desk, you are just observing what is your mass. You will actually take the weighing machine and stand on it and observe what the weight is. But let's say there is another person who actually finds that you are moving with respect to him. So your dimensions would change. I agree with that. But some of your mass will actually convert into energy. And that energy is actually the kinetic energy. I will show what that actually looks like. But some of the mass that he will observe is going to be different. Why is that? Because some of your mass actually got converted into energy. That energy is helping
energy for him, right? Energy for him.
Excuse me, can you repeat?
And that energy is for only for him.
Energy for moving, yes. So you are moving. When you are moving, your energy, you actually have some energy which is helping you move. You know, this is actually not considering any external energy. So don't consider any external force being applied. Yeah. I'm going to show you what that looks like. Just a minute. So this thing that you might all know from famous equations, which is the E equal mc square. So yeah, basically rest mass energy, E naught is equal to m naught c square. But now we are going to think about what would the energy look like if the particle was moving. So that is something, let's see. Also one more thing, abhi humne ek I naam ki cheez derive kari. I'm sure most aapko sabko yaad hoga.
Yes, yes, yeah.
To I mein kya tha hamare paas ki hum ye temporal part tha. This was c dt, right? एंड यहाँ पे हमारे पास स्पेस वाला पार्ट था. तो अब क्योंकि हर फ्रेम के रिस्पेक्ट में आई कॉन्स्टेंट है, ये हमने डिराइव किया. हमने दो फ्रेम्स लिए थे और दोनों फ्रेम्स के रिस्पेक्ट में आई जीरो आया फॉर लाइट. फॉर अदर केसेस इट इज ऑल्सो द सेम, बट उसको डिराइव करने में थोड़ा सा भी और ज्यादा टेक्निकलिटीज है. सो इसलिए आई एम गोइंग टू लीव दैट आउट राइट नाउ. बट जस्ट लेट्स जस्ट यूज दिस एंड थिंक अबाउट वॉट दिस वुड डू फॉर द मोमेंटम टेंसर और द प्रॉपर मोमेंटम. नाउ क्योंकि हमने अभी भी देखा हमने अभी भी देखा कि मोमेंटम एक फोर वेक्टर है. ये एक फोर वेक्टर है. और ऐसा क्यों है, ये फोर वेक्टर क्यों है? फोर वेक्टर बेसिकली वो ऐसा एक फोर डिमेंशनल वेक्टर है जो कि लॉरेंट्स ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन के अकॉर्डिंग ट्रांसफॉर्म होगा. ओके तो ऐसा इसलिए है क्योंकि अभी भी हमने देखा कि ईटा एक फोर डिमेंशनल वेक्टर है और फोर वेक्टर है एंड ईटा ट्रांसफॉर्म्स अकॉर्डिंग टू द रूल ऑफ लॉरेंट्स ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन. तो अगर ईटा ट्रांसफॉर्म कर रहा है तो पी को तो हमने बस ईटा से एम मल्टीप्लाई करके बनाया है, तो पी को भी एक फोर वेक्टर होना चाहिए. और हर एक फोर वेक्टर वो आई इक्वल कॉन्स्टेंट वाली प्रॉपर्टी को सेटिस्फाई करेगा इन एनी फ्रेम. तो मतलब ये जो पी है इसको भी ये प्रॉपर्टी सेटिस्फाई करनी चाहिए. So let's see what that looks like. Okay. So we derived that P mu is equal to M naught gamma C comma. I will just write gamma M naught U. Okay. So अब एक चीज देखते हैं सबसे पहले कि अगर मैं इस टर्म को देखूं तो ये वाला टर्म इसको लेट्स से हम इस टर्म को कहते थे ई बाय सी. देन वी गेट ई इज इक्वल टू एम नॉट सी स्क्वायर. और मैं ऐसा इसलिए क्यों कह रहा हूँ, ये क्यों कह रहा हूँ मैं ऐसा, फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल इसके लिए आपको रीजनिंग देनी चाहिए. जब हमने यू को जीरो पे अप्रोच करवाया था देन हमारे पास कुछ ऐसा स्ट्रक्चर आया था. हमारे पास एक एनर्जी आई थी जिसके बारे में हमें ज्यादा कुछ पता नहीं था, बट वी स्टिल गॉट सम इन्फरेंसेस अबाउट इट. तो मैं एग्जैक्टली सेम चीज कर रहा हूँ, बट मैं इस एनर्जी को बोल रहा हूँ मूविंग एनर्जी. यू नो जब पार्टिकल मूव कर रहा है वो वाली एनर्जी, बिकॉज अगर पार्टिकल मूव नहीं करता तो गामा इज इक्वल टू वन आ जाता है. तो Yeah. So if this is the case, then E is equal to gamma times m naught c square, right? अब अगर आप इसको expand करोगे using binomial theorem, you know, for smaller velocities gamma तो one के पास ही होगा, तो हम binomial theorem को use कर सकते हैं. तो यहाँ पे अगर मैं v square by c square लिख दूँ, sorry, it should be u. Okay. तो anyone can anyone tell me what was binomial theorem and how we apply it? Or can anyone tell me the approximation to this equation, to this expression?
It should be 1 plus u square by c square.
Yeah, u square by 2c square.
Yeah.
Right? So, also, इसमें बाकी टर्म्स भी होंगे, but we are not considering that. हम क्योंकि वेलोसिटी को बहुत छोटा मान रहे हैं, तो बाकी जो हायर ऑर्डर टर्म्स हैं, उनको हम नेगलेक्ट कर रहे हैं. So, this E can be written as m naught c square plus half m naught u square. Is that correct? Okay.
Yes.
Okay. तो अब यहाँ पे आप ये चीज देख सकते हो कि दिस इज समथिंग दैट वी ऑल नो, इट इज द काइनेटिक एनर्जी. फॉर स्मॉलर वेलोसिटीज हम काइनेटिक एनर्जी को यही बोलते थे, और हम ऐसा कुछ हमें पता नहीं था कि पार्टिकल वाज एक्चुअली स्टोरिंग सम एनर्जी इनसाइड इट्स मास. बट ड्यू टू दिस बिहेवियर ऑफ यू नो एक्सपेंशन, वी फाइंड दैट एट रेस्ट पार्टिकल हैज सम एनर्जी विच इज स्टोर्ड इन इट्स मास. And this is energy, what we call the rest energy of the particle. So, अब अगर आप चाहो तो you can find out the energy of the particle or the kinetic energy of the particle when it is moving. How would you do that? जैसे simple सी बात है, particle के पास एक तो total energy है, और वो total energy ये है. And एक particle के पास rest energy है, और वो energy ये है. Now, if I want to find out the जनरल एक्सप्रेशन, ये तो एक अप्रोक्सीमेशन है, बट इफ आई वॉन्ट टू फाइंड आउट द जनरल एक्सप्रेशन फॉर द काइनेटिक एनर्जी, देन वो क्या होगा? एनी गेसेस?
सॉरी, कैन यू रिपीट?
ओके, सो हमने यहाँ पे अप्रोक्सीमेशन किया, दिस वॉज एन अप्रोक्सीमेशन फॉर द टोटल एनर्जी, राइट, इन विच वी फाउंड द रेस्ट एनर्जी टू बी एम नॉट सी स्क्वायर and the kinetic energy to be half m naught u square. This was an approximate kinetic energy. But now if we want to find out what is the kinetic energy when the particle is moving at high speeds, let's say we cannot apply this binomial theorem, then what would be your guess to kinetic energy in the generalized space?
No.
Okay, so let me just tell you. We know that this is the total energy, right? Without approximation, this is the total energy, this. Now, what if I were to subtract the energy that the particle would be having at rest when the particle is not moving?
Not
seen. Right. So this energy will be what? This will be the kinetic energy in general, right?
Yeah.
Yes, yes.
General kinetic energy. This was an approximation. Don't think that this is the general energy, because in our usual life, we actually consider this to be the kinetic energy half m naught c square or half m naught v square, because it is just at low velocities, and we are always observing things at low velocity. We are not going at high velocities. So yeah, this was this thing. Also, we have actually derived what this looks like. Just a minute. Yeah. So now we can write this E as from here, we can write it as this m naught gamma times c square. Okay. Now this thing is what we call the generalized mass, or what you can call the proper mass.
Yeah.
So this is how we get the equal mc square equation. Now, I know for, I mean, if you have any doubts about this derivation, then please ask me. No doubts?
No, clear.
Okay. Cool. So I'm going to conclude this lecture with just a little bit more. I haven't actually used this I being constant in every frame thing. So I'm going to now use it. So, okay. Let's use that. Also, I'm going to provide some additional materials if any of you are interested in learning more. So first of all, Griffiths is a good book for this relativity thing. But if you want to go higher up and learn about the tensors thing, then there is also some nice things in about tensors in the Afkin book. I will share the PDF of all those with you. So don't worry.
What kind of mathematical background do we need to understand?
Okay, so first of all, you must be very comfortable with linear algebra. And also, you know, you don't have to worry about it, but most of you might have also learned about multivariable calculus, I'm assuming.
Yes,
I mean,
yes, it's
not been taught in the usual course, but, you know, Khan Academy exists and we all are familiar with it. So, okay, we back to the topic. We know that I is equal to, what was it? It was x0 dx0 square minus dx1 square and blah, blah, blah. So this actually signifies the component. And one more thing I want to mention is that it doesn't have to be infinitesimal changes. It can be finite changes also. So I can actually remove this d and make it just delta x0. And delta x prime square and blah, blah, blah. I have actually derived this using a very loose intuition, but this is actually valid in other circumstances also. So now what if I were to use the momentum, generalized momentum, which was P mu, it was E by C, comma, gamma m naught. Ab gamma m naught ko, I will just write as m, okay?
Okay.
And this will be just m times u. So this, I'm assuming, is the generalized mass. And this is the energy for the particle moving. Okay. Now, then what we do is we actually see what is its zeroth component. Its zeroth component is this, right? So this is actually the P0. And this contains P1, P2, P3. So what we can do is we can find out what I is. So I is actually equal to, first of all, P0 square, which is E by C square minus. Now, any suggestions on what the square of this will be or what this when substituted here will look like? Hello?
Square common and those different.
Yes, yes.
Like yes. UX square and UY square.
So it will be M naught gamma and u square.
Yeah.
Cool. So now we are going to think about what the value of I is going to be. Now, humne abhi bhi dekha ki the value of I actually doesn't change from frame to frame. It's a constant thing. So even if I were to measure I in my own frame, then that value will be equal to this. So I, when u is equal to 0. Is that comfort? Are you all comfortable with this?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. So what is this E at u equals to 0? We all know it is m naught c square, right?
Yeah.
So and this becomes zero when u is equal to zero. So we can just say that this above equation will e is equal to m naught c square. So we will have m naught c square divided by c, which is going to cancel out this two, and this will be whole square. So also we can just rearrange this denominator, this c in the denominator, and find that we can have this is the momentum. So we can just write it as the proper momentum square, or I'm just going to leave this p out because now we are all comfortable with it, and this is going to be c square here. Okay, so this is also one of the equations that you might have seen a lot, if you might have seen some articles related to relativity. This equation is very, very useful in solving problems related to collision and in particle physics also. This is actually very helpful in particle physics. We are not even at the level of using this general relativity with quantum mechanics. We only use special theory of relativity with quantum mechanics right now. So that's why this is very, very unique equation and very useful equation. Any of you have seen this equation before?
I have.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so this is how you actually derive it. So I have actually missed some of the details about this invariant I, Lorentz invariant. You can, in your free time, go about reading about this, and it's going to be really worth it if you read about it. Also, one more thing I would closely suggest you to read is, I see there are some sections in Griffiths which are amazing. So this section about space-time diagrams is really great. You can read about it and solve this problem. Yeah, this problem. Problem number 12.22. It's a very great problem, and you might get confused at first, but it's a really great feeling. You can read this poem and conclude about what this poem is trying to say. And in the end, you might find something nice about this question. Yeah, okay, sure. So also one more thing you can read is this book, Afkin. If you are, mathematically inclined, this is the chapter I would recommend. And the book name is Afkin. So I will share it with you. So no problem. And so you can first of all read about this contravariant and covariant thing. This is very simple to understand, not very big deal. It's simply just notation thing, nothing else. They are just trying to confuse you with the notations. It's a very simple concept otherwise. Also, I would closely recommend you to study about the metric tensor, which is right over here. Yes, so this metric tensor is a very, very simple thing, but it has very very great consequences in physics, and you will actually love studying about it because it has you might have used these gradients and other things, but you might be struggling to find, like, let me show you one thing. Ye expression sabne dekha hai, but most of us actually get worried about from where did this even came from. So yeah, aap sabne ye wali expressions dekhe honge gradient ke liye aur del dotted bhi dekhe liye, ye sari expression aate hain metric tensor ka use karke, and a lot of things ye matlab maine derive bhi karke de rakha tha us video mein, shayad dekha tha aapne, agar kisi ne dekha ho to. और ये सारी एक्सप्रेशन आप खुद से भी डिराइव कर सकते हो अगर आपको थोड़ा बहुत मैट्रिक टेंसर के बारे में पता हो तो, एंड मेमोराइज करने की कोई जरूरत नहीं पड़ेगी फिर. दिस विल बी वेरी इजी टू राइट डाउन. आगे इफ यू स्टडी अ लिटिल बिट अबाउट क्वांटम मैकेनिक्स, देन दीज आर वेरी यूजफुल इन सॉल्विंग द श्रोडिंगर इक्वेशन. सो या दैट इज इट. और अगर किसी को कोई क्वेश्चन है तो प्लीज अनम्यूट योरसेल्फ एंड आस्क. Yes, yes.
I just wanted to clarify something. When we were talking about when u is negligible, right? E is equals to mc squared plus. Why don't we just completely ignore m not u squared? Because u will be small, I assume, and c squared is such a big quantity.
Just a minute. Okay. So you are talking about this case. You are saying that we should ignore this m not c squared.
No, we were talking about kinetic energies and
okay.
E is equal to m not c squared.
Right here.
Yes, yes. This one. Approximation where you've written.
Okay, okay. So you're saying that we should ignore this quantity, right?
Yes, because I assume it's very small.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, you are completely right. But my point was very simple that if u is small, then this kinetic energy is negligible, right? And let's say you are there and you, of course, would not experience this energy because it's stored inside you as your mass. But when you are moving with some velocity, you certainly will observe this energy, or you cannot observe it, but it's there in your motion. That this is the only thing that is driving your motion. But what I was saying that, you know, at smaller velocities, this can be ignored. I completely agree with that. And in the classical case, we observe this kinetic energy because this energy cannot be extracted easily. You know, you would have to actually explode yourself with the bomb to experience this energy. Otherwise, it's not possible. But this kinetic energy, actually at higher speeds, we observe this in particle accelerators. Particle accelerators like synchrotron radiation and a lot of things. You might have heard about LHC, Large Hadron Collider, at CERN.
Yeah.
Exactly. At CERN, they utilize this kinetic energy, or they actually convert this m naught c squared into the moving kinetic energy. They somehow extract this much energy. They actually make the particle go around and around and around. And when it reaches a very high velocity, then you can see that due to this dependence on gamma of this kinetic energy. So let me just show you what kinetic energy is. So we know that E is equal to m naught gamma times. So this is m naught gamma times c square, right? So that would mean that the generalized kinetic energy is m naught c square gamma minus 1. Cool. Now at lower velocities, gamma is equal to 1. Right?
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
As we reach higher velocities, this gamma increases, which means the kinetic energy increases a lot. And if you were to somehow reach close to the speed of light, which actually happens at the Large Hadron Collider, they actually reach 99.999% the speed of light. So this gamma actually explodes to infinity, which means a lot of kinetic energy. And a lot of kinetic energy means a lot of fast moving particles inside the collider. And that is what we want to observe, the standard model particles like Higgs boson and other things.
Okay, sir. Clear.
Yeah. Any more questions?
No, not that I can think of.
Okay. If you have any questions, then please ping me in the Discord, G-Shock, and ask me those questions. I will reply as soon as possible. Also, I will share this PDF with all of you. Some things are not covered because we actually didn't discuss them. So if you are curious about them, then please read the books. And that's it from my side for this session. Okay, so yeah, goodbye.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Also, recording को upload कर देना मतलब बादल recording जिसके भी पास save होगी